give them a round of applause again.
Before I acknowledge students who received honors last night, I would like to mention recent events on campus. We've had a very trying week as a community and individually. It is clear we continue to struggle to sustain civil discourse. We also have not yet created a community that is safe for all. I know you join me in learning from these recent events. Let us use the remaining weeks of the term to find ways to support each other and strengthen our community. As I said in a note to the community that should be out shortly, we also plan to use the summer to find ways to improve the framework of discussion on campus and enhance mechanisms that create a safer community for all. It was my pleasure to host last night's honors dinner, where we celebrated the special accomplishments of 94 students and 6 faculty and staff. Today, those award winners are joined by students elected to honor societies, and we all have the opportunity to congratulate these outstanding members of the Lawrence community. A complete list of our award winners can be found in today's program. As I announce the category that pertains to you, please rise to be recognized and then be seated. Will all students who received awards for athletics please rise? Congratulations. Will all students who received college or conservatory academic and music awards please rise? Congratulations. Will all students who received an award last night for your contribution to campus life please rise? Congratulations. Will the following faculty stand and remain standing so we can recognize you as a group? The Babcock Award for Outstanding Service to Students and voted on by students was presented to Leah McSorley, Director of International Student Services. Faculty Convocation Award to Janet Anthony, George and Marjorie Olson, Chandler Professor of Music, and Paul Cohen, Patricia Hammer Bolt, Professor of Liberal Studies and Professor of History. Mortarboard Honorary Award to Dina Scran, the Edwin and Ruth West Professor of Economics and Social Science and Professor of Government. University Award for Excellence in Advising to Nick Keelan, Associate Professor of Music. Nick is out of town for a performance, but we should congratulate him anyway. Freshman Studies Teaching Award to Ame Balsakar, Associate Professor of Government. Congratulations. You can be seated. And now to recognize membership in honor societies. Will all those students elected to Lambda Sigma, someone should give me a lesson here. Lambda Sigma, the Sophomore Honor Society, please rise. Congratulations. Mortarboard, the Senior Honor Society, please rise. Congratulations. Pi Kappa Lambda, the Music Honor Society. Please rise. Congratulations. And finally, Phi Beta Kappa, the most prestigious academic honor society for seniors. Please rise. Let's have one more round of applause for all of our award winners. And now we will have a musical selection entitled Diffusus.
Thank you. Wow, wasn't that wonderful? How about another round of applause? Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. I am honored and delighted to present today's co-winner of the Faculty Convocation Award, Professor of History and Patricia Hamar Bolt Professor of Liberal Studies, Paul Cohen. Professor Cohen has had a long time interest in questions of the moral and ethical character of leaders. As a graduate student, he wrote a seminar paper on Sartre's Ethic of Heroism, and his PhD dissertation was on piety and politics. I can't resist pointing out that Sartre also wrote something called The Flies. But, oh boy. I don't think that has anything to do with today's talk at all. This interest in the relationship between personal and political character has evolved into important questions about masculinity and leadership. In a recent article, Professor Cohen made the point that one of our political parties has stated that presidential leaders should be stand-up guys, can stay the course, and like the idea that sometimes a man's got to do what a man's got to do. The other party likes to emphasize the idea that problems can be solved through compromise, yielding, and in general, talking and thinking through the issues. And no, he's not talking about a faculty meeting. He's talking about political parties. There is no prize other than pride of understanding for correctly figuring out Professor Cohen's conclusions about which party favors which view. Paul Cohen earned a Bachelor of Arts degree in history at Clark University in 1977, a Master of Arts degree in history in 1979, and a PhD in 1984, both at the University of Chicago. He came to Lawrence in 1985 as an assistant professor of history, was promoted to associate professor in 1991, and to the rank of professor in 1999. His work has included the publication of two books and the careful mentoring of generations of students whom he has successfully challenged to high levels of achievement that even they thought they could not attain. He is known as a wise counselor to faculty colleagues, particularly helping them through the complex odyssey of academic life. He has had many awards and honors during his career. He was selected for the Freshman Studies Teaching Prize in 1999 and the Excellent Teacher Award in 2008. In 2003, his outstanding work, both as a teacher and scholar, was recognized by his selection as the Patricia Hamar Bolt Professor of Liberal Studies. Professor Cohen has studied carefully the characteristics and flaws of our president of the United States. And the influence of these characteristics on their behavior. He has pointed out that we have examined and talked about age, race, and many other characteristics. What we have not carefully analyzed is the characteristic of masculinity. Today's presentation will shine a bright light on that topic. With great pleasure, I give you my good friend, Professor Paul Cohen, who will speak on Presidential Manhood, Masculinity and American Politics in the Age of Mass Media.
Thank you very much. I want to first congratulate the honorees. Quite a performance from you. Way to go. I also want to thank my friend and colleague, Dave Burrows. Perhaps I can return the favor. I would finally like to thank my personal genie, Linda Peters, who has done an unbelievable job arranging things for this convocation. So, let's get started. In the presidential election of 1840, William Henry Harrison and his supporters sneered at the feminine ruffled shirt and silken hose of his incumbent opponent, Martin Van Buren. Their guy, they claimed, was by contrast a man of humble log cabin extraction who drank plain hard cider. A real man. Playing the rough-hewn man of the people surely helped Harrison win the election, but there were consequences. At his inauguration, fearing to appear unmanly on a bitterly cold day, he refused a top coat, caught pneumonia, and died a month later. Their manhood has its consequences. Nevertheless, concludes sociologist Michael Kimmel, since 1840, the president's manhood has always been a question. His manly resolve, firmness, courage, and power equated with the capacity for violence, military virtues, and a plain living style that avoided cultivated refinement. Now, what I'd like to do here this morning is ask how Kimmel's claim might apply to more recent American presidential elections, especially since 9/11. I'll therefore focus on the likes of George W. Bush, John Kerry, Barack Obama, Hillary Clinton, and yes, Donald Trump, though he won't hog up as much airtime as he is accustomed to. Since the recent election, there's been an overabundance of explanations for Trump's unexpected electoral victory, just to name a few. The revolt of rural versus urban voters, the populist revolt against Washington and Wall Street, the bigoted hatred of Hillary, can't forget that one, the bigoted repudiation of Obama and of the Black, Hispanic, Muslim, and LGBTQ communities. James Comey, you remember him, he used to head the FBI? Yeah. And last but not least, Vladimir Putin, perhaps in collusion with the Trump campaign. We'll see. All of these certainly contain elements of truth. Fortunately, as a historian, it is not my job just yet to offer an empirical answer to that question, the question of who voted for Trump and why. That I'll leave to my stalwart colleagues in political science who possess more facts and a stronger constitution than I. The humbler claim I'll make here is that on-screen masculine performance played a larger role in this election and in American presidential politics more generally than we have recognized thus far. It seems self-evident to me that images of archetypal masculinity, invariably white and heterosexual, surround us constantly. Yet I'd argue that when it comes to understanding American politics, we often take masculine archetypes for granted. We live within their confines rather than looking at them. I want to look at them. I'll argue that particularly in the age of mass media, the question of which candidate appears more manly, and I'll underline appears, has played an outsized role in deciding who will be president. Accordingly, I'll examine not the candidates themselves here so much as the images of them that have graced our TV, computer, and smartphone screens. Now, you may have noticed that I used the phrase masculine performance, which will be familiar to some of you. It should, in any case, give you some idea about where I'm coming from. Following gender theorist Judith Butler, I'll assume that gender is not a biological or innate property, but rather a cultural and historical construction. Gender, Butler maintains, lies at the heart of the stories we tell about ourselves in order to give shape and meaning and sense to our lives. We enact the roles available to us at a given time and place by performing them as if in a play that nobody knows is a play, and one on which the curtain never falls. How we dress, how we wear our hair, how we walk and talk are all part of the performance. Do we perform our parts consciously? For the most part, no. But we quickly learn if we're playing them right, because we're rewarded socially if we do, and punished if we don't. Anyone who's braved a middle school playground or a high school cafeteria can attest to that. Yes, like it or not, traditional gender performances remain the norm even in 2017. As for how exactly we absorb and internalize the gendered roles we are commanded to perform, mass media surely plays a crucial role. The cultural theorist Raymond Williams has underscored the totalizing effects of media culture in our age and its production of hegemony, that is, the lived system of meaning and values that determines who possesses power and who does not. Because of their high entertainment value and their success in engineering consent, expands literary scholar David Savran, the cultural texts of mass media are decisive in the ongoing production of hegemony. And because we live in a patriarchal culture, tales of heroic manhood could still dominate the various electronic devices that command our attention. And I suspect that some of you might be looking at yours as I speak. Indeed, fictional characters played by such icons of Hollywood masculinity as, come on, there he is, John Wayne, Clint Eastwood, updated by the likes of Bruce Willis, Harrison Ford, Tom Cruise, Matt Damon, still haunt our collective imagination. So, Returning to Kimmel's proposition with gun pointed at your head, here are the rules of the masculine reality show, let's call it Who's a Real Man, otherwise known as presidential politics in the media age. Rule number one, to be successful, candidates must both establish their masculinity and avoid being feminized. That requires them to cultivate a screen image of courage and decisiveness and display a willingness to exercise military violence on behalf of the American people. That is, to play father protector of the nation. Rule number two, regardless of how wealthy or culturally sophisticated they might be, they must impersonate a regular guy. Think Rhodes Scholar Bill Clinton doing his Arkansas Bubba shtick. Rule number three, candidates must avoid appearing weak, indecisive, effete, or overeducated. Professors, I'm afraid, are unmanly by definition. No feminine or gay refinements are allowed. Thus, weird upscale vegetables like arugula are verboten, and one must keep one's yachts, private jets, and multiple mansions out of the public view. It's okay to have them, you just can't display them, okay? Football, NASCAR, and hunting are good. Soccer, tennis, windsurfing, not so much. Golf apparently gets a pass as long as you don't putt during a crisis. Rule number four, any feats of traditional masculine prowess that candidates have actually performed in their lifetimes count for nothing. Let me repeat that one. Any feats of traditional masculine prowess that candidates have actually performed in their lifetimes count for nothing. Thus, the military service of George H.W. Bush, a World War II pilot, shot down in the line of duty, Jimmy Carter, a former submarine commander, Bob Dole, a partially disabled veteran of World War II, and the Vietnam War veterans, John Kerry and John McCain, did not inoculate them against having their manhood questioned by the likes of Ronald Reagan, Bill Clinton, George W. Bush, Barack Obama, and Donald Trump, none of whom had served. Image is indeed everything. Finally, rule number five. Rules number one through four apply to male and female candidates alike, or rather, as we'll see, if you're a woman wanting to run for president, you have to adhere to them even more closely. Now, I want you to try to keep these rules in mind as we move forward. There might be a quiz at the end. But before we do, let's warm up with a pre-9/11 example. In the election of 1988, the media advisors for George H.W. Bush knew that their candidate had a manhood problem, as this Newsweek cover so bluntly suggests. Pictured here in full Thurston Howell III mode. So there are still Gilligan's Island fans out there. Oh, I'm so gratified to hear that. The former World War II pilot had to dispel the media image of himself as a privileged high-toned aristocrat, which of course he was. But as psychologist Stephen Duckett notes, aristic affectations are, quote, markers of femininity. So Bush attempted to play regular guy, by claiming to love country music and pork rinds. His version, I suppose, of William Henry Harrison's Plain Hard Cider. He had the great good fortune, moreover, to draw as his opponent the former Massachusetts governor, Michael Dukakis. As the short, nerdy son of Greek immigrants, Dukakis arrived on the public stage with built-in liabilities, masculinity-wise. But his on-screen performance made matters much worse. An opponent of the death penalty, already marked as an effeminate position, he was asked during a debate how he would respond if his wife were raped and murdered. His bland, legalistic answer led him, following the debate, to be, quote, savaged by Republicans and most reporters for failing to summon manly emotion. Real men, after all, must pose as protectors. See rule number one, especially of their women. Worse yet, attempting to reinflate his masculine image, Dukakis visited a tank factory, donned a combat helmet, and rode in an M1 Abrams tank. The result was this. Once possessed of a 17-point lead in the polls, he lost to Thurston Howell by 426 to 111 points, votes in the Electoral College. Now, Bush's eldest son, George W. Bush, could hardly have been in the real world anything but the privileged offspring of his aristocratic father. A graduate of Phillips Andover Academy, and then of Yale and Harvard Business School, he sidestepped service in Vietnam, probably with some behind-the-help scenes from Dad, by becoming a pilot in the Texas and Alabama National Guards. As a presidential candidate, the younger Bush and his handlers were determined that he not be framed on screen as an upper-class wimp like his dad. Bush was raised in Texas, born in Connecticut, but raised in Texas, and he honed his down-home accent and regular guy demeanor and employed them to good effect in the campaign, in campaign ads and television appearances. He squeaked by Al Gore in the election of 2000. There are some who would still argue with that. Florida, hanging chads, I won't go there. But he had yet to distinguish himself as president. Then the 9/11 attacks presented him with an opportunity to perform the role of a lifetime, fashioning himself thenceforward as a war president in a newly declared and invented war on terror, he would play America's cowboy in chief. In assuming that role, Bush laid claim to one of the great myths of American manhood. Now let me pause here, both for a drink, and to offer you a brief history of the cowboy myth. Historian Anthony Rotundo finds its roots at the rise of what he calls passionate manhood toward the end of the 19th century. Until that time, Rotundo explains, manhood in America was defined primarily by the standard masculine-feminine divide. You all know it, hard versus soft, strong versus weak, independent versus dependent, and so forth. Okay, but that divide wasn't the real divide until the period I'm talking about. The real divide was the man-boy divide. Okay, one attained manhood by discarding the impatience, impulsiveness, and combativeness of a boy in favor of the duties, rationality, and self-restraint of a man. But for middle-class white men, the end of the century proved a trying time. The Western frontier had closed, the population had shifted massively from country to city. Individual enterprise and self-sufficiency were being displaced by corporate capitalism and its, quote, army of executives, salespeople, and clerical workers, as Rotundo puts it, and women were invading the public sphere, both at work and beyond. Such men, in short, felt emasculated. In defense of the ostensibly imperiled virtues of manly toughness and autonomy, passionate manhood championed some of the very attributes, combativeness, impulsiveness, willfulness, that had previously been stigmatized as boyish. And it sought as well to purge all that was feminine from its soul, including any trace of homosexuality, which was equated with effeminacy. Thus, passionate manhood gave rise to such epithets as sissy, milksop, and fairy. The cowboy myth emerged at the turn of the 20th century as part of this powerfully gendered critique of urban industrial civilization. The hero of the Western, the cowboy, was a regular guy as knight errant, a man in his intrepid exploits, writes Rotundo, but as heedless of civilized restraint as a boy. And whereas the cowboy myth rendered boyishness manly, it conjured a world from which the feminine was excluded. Westerns, writes gender scholar Jackson Katz, became a fictional space within which men could assert masculine power without apology, and where feminine traits, so-called, such as empathy and compassion, were seen as shortcomings in men who had to tame the wild frontier. The era's most celebrated passionate man was President Teddy Roosevelt, who famously championed, quote, the iron qualities that must go with true manhood, the positive virtues of resolution, of courage, of indomitable will. But he also, writes Rotundo, embodied many of the traits associated with boyhood: energy, candor, impatience, combativeness, and impulsiveness. One Roosevelt associate wrote, "You must always remember that the president is about six." This was a relatively new development. As my opening saga of William Henry Harrison suggests, the need for presidential candidates to avoid being feminized was present even in 1840. But no one had ever accused, say, Washington, Jefferson, or Lincoln of being boyish or passionate men. Okay, so this was new, which it would seem would bring us back to George W. Bush, who took his stage directions directly from the now mythologized genre of the Western. Shortly after the tragedy of 9/11, he cast its probable perpetrator, Osama bin Laden, as freedom-hating outlaw and himself as sheriff. "There's an old poster out west," he proclaimed, "that says, wanted, dead or alive." Thereafter, Bush performed the part of plain-spoken cowboy warrior, mostly by channeling Hollywood's most celebrated Westerner, you remember him, John Wayne. "I don't do nuance," he brashly reminded the public more than once. In 2003, responding to the possibility of attacks on American troops by Iraqi militants, Bush notoriously claimed, "Bring them on." And at the Republican convention in 2004, he pleased the crowd by mocking the folks who, quote unquote, look at me and see a certain swagger. In Texas, we call it walking. Nor did Bush stop at channeling John Wayne. Celebrating the supposed end of combat operations in Iraq in May of 2003, the cowboy in chief morphed into flyboy in chief, and John Wayne became Tom Cruise. Here is Bush landing on the USS Abraham Lincoln in the co-pilot's seat of a fighter jet. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not suggesting that Bush's post 9/11 performance was simply phony, just an act. Certainly aspects of the show, the Top Gun moment, to be sure, were staged. But you'll recall that masculine performance need not be conscious or intentional, and Bush seemed very much to buy his own act. Still, I am hardly the first to focus critical attention on his performance of cowboy masculinity. This Oliphant cartoon graces the cover of Bush World, a compilation of columns by the liberal-leaning New York Times columnist Maureen Dowd. Focusing almost obsessively on Bush's need to prove his manhood and surpass his father's, Dowd branded him the boy emperor and devoted an entire column to slamming his Top Gun turn. President Bush's Achilles heel, she wrote in May of 2004, is his fear of wimpiness. And Dick Cheney and Rummy played on that, making him think that we had to go to war or he would lose face and no longer be the man. Nonetheless, Bush's performance played well during the election of 2004. Apart from fulfilling the requirements of rule number one, remember that quiz? Look decisive, be willing to employ military violence, avoid being feminized. He earned still more points by winning the much ballyhooed Man I'd Rather Drink a Beer With contest. Pretty odd way to choose a president, you might think, particularly in the case of a recovering alcoholic teetotaler from Andover and Yale. But it all makes sense from the standpoint of masculine performance. Rule number two, candidates must project regular guyness. And rule number four, what one does in real life counts for nothing. Image is everything. Like his father, moreover, Bush was fortunate in his opponent. Senator John Kerry proved an easy mark. Kerry's first mistake was to bet his real-life masculine credentials as decorated war veteran against Bush's enactment of real manhood. He accepted his party's nomination with a salute and a declaration. I'm John Kerry, and I'm reporting for duty. The Bush campaign, or rather its surrogates, claimed that Kerry had exaggerated and even fabricated his service record. The charge was later proved false, but the damage was done. Meanwhile, Karl Rove and his minions relentlessly feminized the senator. Kerry, as gender psychologist Meredith Curry details, was painted as a flip-flopper, a vacillator, wishy-washy, wobbly, and waffling. Hard to do. Nor did he help matters himself, having famously proclaimed that he had voted for an Iraq war spending bill before I voted against it. Rove's minions lampooned Kerry as an upper-crust sportsman who enjoyed, as Jackson Katz recounts, skiing, snowboarding, and windsurfing. By contrast, the equally upper crust George W. Bush cultivated the image of, quote, an average guy who rides in pickup trucks and likes baseball. Kerry, they charged, was overly cerebral and verbose, and worse yet, he looked and even spoke French. Read weak and effeminate, especially since the French had failed to support the invasion of Iraq. Does anybody remember Freedom Fries? Yeah, best forget it. All of this was neatly encapsulated in the title of a 2004 New York Times column by Frank Rich, How John Kerry Became a Girly Man. As in the case of Dukakis, Kerry's attempts to buff up his manly image proved semi-disastrous. Here he is, after having ridden a Harley onto the stage of The Tonight Show. And here's a cartoonist's rendering of Kerry's adventures as a goose hunter. And since I don't doubt the people in the back can read that, I'll read it for you. Kerry's saying, I enjoy procuring said waterfowl with a firearm because I'm a regular guy like Joe Cosmopolitan. And this guy is responding, six-pack, Senator, Joe six-pack. Having won three debates with Bush in the judgment of the cable news punditry, Kerry lost the election in Ohio, where working-class white men chose the media cowboy over the media-challenged war veteran. But if media masculinity so often wins out, you may well ask how a skinny, half-black junior senator from Illinois defeated a war hero and self-proclaimed maverick in 2008. Good question. I'm glad you asked. First off, Obama was blessed by circumstances that placed the who's a real man game on temporary hiatus. By 2007, the Iraq War had become hugely unpopular and Bush's Cowboy Act had worn thin. Indeed, one of the primary arguments for Obama's candidacy, particularly in the primaries against Hillary Clinton, was his early opposition to the war. Then, the economic crash in October of 2007 made the election more about protecting the economy, about which McCain admitted to knowing next to nothing, than projecting power in the Middle East. Nevertheless, to be elected, Obama had to perform a nationally televised high wire act over the perilous rapids of race and gender. That is, he had to appear black enough to secure the vast majority of African-American votes, but not so much as to discomfort the rest. And he had to appear tough and decisive enough, manly enough, to pass the wimp test, but sufficiently benign, as Jackson Katz puts it, quote, to ease the anxieties of white voters who over the decades had been conditioned to fear the anger and potential violence of black men. Quite a trick, as the comedy team of Key and Peele recognized in their justly acclaimed routine about Obama's anger translator. For those of you who don't know, that's Peele playing the presidential Obama, and that's Key playing Luther, who's expressing what Obama really feels. Great routine. Obama proved an unusually nimble performer, but at times he fell off the wire and paid dearly. Here he is in the spring of 2008, trying to connect with rural white voters in Pennsylvania. Mistake. Commenting on what he called Obama's dainty bowling performance, a score of 37 punctuated by several gutter balls, Republican pundit Joe Scarborough jeered, "Americans want their president, if he is a man, to be a real man." Once Obama became president, the conservative media establishment, knowing it couldn't openly attack him on race, hammered him incessantly on gender. The president's role in the killing of Osama bin Laden and his controversial use of drone warfare did not stop Fox News from mocking him as a weak commander-in-chief who wore mom jeans, led from behind in Libya and Syria, and kowtowed to foreign leaders, most notably to Russia's real man, Vladimir Putin. I'm told that that's Photoshop, but I don't know. Did Fox News or Republican politicians actually advocate sending American troops to Libya, Syria, or Ukraine? Well, not exactly. What they apparently yearned for was tougher talk, more manly oratory. In trying to be sensitive to Muslim feelings, which they disdained as political correctness, Obama had failed, in their view, to bloody our foes manfully with the phrase radical Islamic terrorism. And while we obviously could not risk war with Russia, the president needed to stand up to Putin with more masculine rhetoric. Obama, in short, inspired an odd nostalgia for Bush-like masculine bombast. Somewhat surprisingly, that nostalgia was shared by more than a few Obama critics on the left who craved a president willing to take a more warrior-like stance against Republicans and other foes. Leading the "Obama is a wimp" chorus on the left, interestingly enough, was our old friend Maureen Dowd of the New York Times, who had so wickedly skewered George W. Bush's masculine performance. Having nicknamed the senator Obambi in 2007, she characterized Obama thereafter as elite, effete, a feminized man, and worst of all, an over-intellectualized professor. We all know what that means. In April of 2008, she warned, "What turns voters off is the detached egghead quality that they tend to equate with wimpiness, wordiness, and a lack of action." In 2009, in a column she entitled "Less Spocky, More Rocky," she likened the president to Star Trek's famously over-cerebral alien. And in the same year, she taxed Obama for failing to recognize that Americans want their president to be the strong father who protects the home from invaders. Dowd's assault on Obama's manhood did not pass unnoticed. The liberal website Media Matters called her out for feminizing Obama, and I would have to agree. In my terms, Dowd was indicting Obama for breaking rule number 3, never appear weak, effete, or professorial. It's particularly telling, I would argue, that a journalist as attuned to gender as Maureen Dowd remained so stuck in the standard masculine-feminine binary. In her world, apparently, a president or presidential candidate must either be a cowboy or a wimp. Now, Hillary Clinton, of course, has long walked her own media-made tightrope over gender identity. And she has walked it without the benefit of Obama's uncanny performative grace. Since entering the public eye in the early 1990s, Clinton has served as a national lightning rod for gender politics. During her husband's campaign, during her husband's first presidential campaign, she became an emblem of third wave feminism. Some of you will recall that she then went by Hillary Rodham Clinton and famously dissed the baking of cookies and the wifely duty championed by country singer Tammy Wynette to stand by her man. She went on to flout the traditional role of First Lady by piloting her husband's campaign for universal health care, but harshly criticized in the media as too high-powered, too aggressive, that is, too masculine. She ditched the Rodham, baked cookies, and withdrew from any role in public policy. Worse yet, during the Monica Lewinsky scandal of the late 1990s, Clinton found herself more or less forced into the role of good wife, standing by her man, which earned her both public sympathy and derision for not kicking Bill out, that is, for being too feminine. After being elected to the Senate in 2000, Clinton set about remasculinizing her image in preparation for a presidential run. Her fateful 2002 vote in favor of the Iraq War must be understood, I think, in that light. Jackson Katz suggests, and I agree, that as a woman, she had no choice but to take a hawkish position if she wanted to be elected president. Of course, the vote, ironically, provided the opening for Obama's successful run in 2008. But following the advice of her pollster, Mark Penn, who insisted that, quote, the only way a woman could win the presidency in 2008 would be to position her as tough enough to lead the country in time of war, Hillary continued to man up. A labor leader introduced her in 2007 as a woman with testicular fortitude. And here she is doing the regular guy beer and shots thing with some of those ever lusted after Joe Sixpack types. See rule number two, play the regular guy. You recall that I warned you that it was going to be, that she was still going to have to play by these rules. Meanwhile, just as Obama downplayed race in his campaign to become the nation's first black president, Clinton downplayed gender in her campaign to become its first female one. One wonders if in 2008 and 2016, Clinton was really more hawkish in her heart of hearts than Obama, and if her support for the Iraq War in 2002 was out of personal conviction or just following rule number one of who's a real man game, display resolve and the willingness to exercise military force. In any case, the strategy clearly worked well enough for a while. Rarely did anyone, Republicans, Fox News, or even Trump, questioned her toughness, her manly capacity, as it were, to fill the role of commander-in-chief. In 2016, while still periodically reminding us, with some help from the media, of her prowess in the real man game, Clinton's campaign felt free to focus on making her more likable and relatable, read more feminine, and to capitalize on Trump's woman problem. Clinton's previous reluctance to play the first woman as president card disappeared, and children, family, and community replaced beer and shots. Yet, like a Kerry or a Dukakis, Clinton was clearly out of her comfort zone in front of a camera. It's fair to ask, in fact, if the questions about her honesty, about honesty, likability, and authenticity that have dogged Clinton throughout her career are not, at least in part, the product of an inept media performance. Her toggling between masculinized and feminized personas was blatant enough to be read as opportunistic, and her attempts to mask the contradictions between her public persona and private behavior, the notorious emails, the lucrative Wall Street speeches, and so on, were artless enough to be read as quasi-criminal. And of course, she wasn't nearly as compelling to watch as her opponent. I didn't need a drink before this. As for him, I hope by now that the case of Trump will seem obvious. For surely he represents the logical extension of what I've been arguing about both the media and masculinity. The Trumpian lesson concerning the media might sound strangely comforting, but it is in fact deeply disturbing. Donald J. Trump is not real. By this I don't mean that there is not an actual flesh and blood entity who calls himself Donald Trump, but rather that the Donald Trump we know is no more than a fictional character constructed entirely by the man and his media enablers. That Trump is nothing more than a media cartoon. That Trump has never stopped playing himself on reality TV. He is what the French philosopher Jean Baudrillard would call hyper-real, the perfect image of himself. Now, French though it may be, that idea is not as baked as it may seem at first. I hear that while captaining the Colbert Report, Stephen Colbert was often asked to speak at colleges like Lawrence. He would respond by asking in return, "Do you want Stephen Colbert or Stephen Colbert? The person or the persona?" The reason, again, that many of us find Hillary Clinton inauthentic is that we detect a substantial gap between the Hillary Clinton we see in the media and the real person we don't see but sense is there. And since her media performance of herself is less than convincing, we think that she's always hiding something. But do we ever ask, as we do of most politicians, if there's a difference between what Trump says and what he really thinks? Do we imagine a real Donald Trump beyond his media performance? No, Donald Trump is his media performance. That had its advantages during the campaign. For one thing, it allowed this flamboyantly wealthy tycoon and serial exaggerator, some would say liar, to lay claim to the title of regular guy champion of the oppressed white working class who tells it like it is. For regardless of the multiple occasions on which he clearly lied, he was always himself. He seemed more truthful, more authentic than Clinton, for he never appeared to be hiding anything. Trump's singular dubious achievement, remarks veteran New Yorker writer and Trumpographer Mark Singer, has been to remain fully in character at all times. He has deliberately chosen to exist only as a persona, never as a person. And that seemed to work for his followers. Donald Trump is everything Hillary Clinton is not, affirmed a female supporter from Wisconsin in July of 2016. I hope she's not here. He is blunt, direct, and strong. He speaks his mind. Trump's media persona also allowed him to flout the usual rules of presidential campaigning in a way that would have doomed anyone else. He could diss John McCain's heroic military service, insult the family of a dead soldier, and make racist remarks about Mexicans and blacks. Why? Because he was merely an outsized screen character to most of us. So we didn't have to take his pronouncements literally as we would were he a professional politician with serious convictions or real plans to run the country. And as a character, we supporters and detractors alike found him endlessly fascinating. Since the media covered every appearance and tweet, he never stopped reminding us of how high ratings he got. Trump dominated our screens. We watched him compulsively and awaited his next outrage with relish or dread, depending on our preferences. What politically incorrect or absurdly tasteless thing would Donald Trump say next? We're media junkies, and Trump became our latest addiction. But functioning as a media character has its downside, too. Since Trump had always to be Trump, he couldn't readily change his strategy, respond in new ways to new situations, admit to being wrong, or to changing his mind. He was unable to appear traditionally presidential when the need arose, for that would require a media performance fundamentally foreign to his persona. He'd have to appear prudent, responsible, and well-informed. And who would buy that or watch it? Oops. Donald Trump had to remain Donald Trump, just as Homer Simpson had to remain always Homer Simpson. They must stay in character. And like Homer, Trump repeated now the same blunders over and over again. Don't. It's not easy being two-dimensional. Yet also like Homer, the Trump cartoon bounced back from his most damaging pratfalls in the same shape as before. As for what staying in character meant for Trump, that's the obvious part. He has performed and continues to perform a caricature of Rotondo's passionate man. That archetype, you'll recall, emerged at a time when the definition of adult manhood embraced traits previously stigmatized as boyish, such as impulsiveness, willfulness, combativeness. As columnist Frank Bruni recently put it, Trump has enacted a burlesque of manhood within what some sociologists have labeled the man box, a model of manhood that includes aggression, hypersexuality, and supreme authority. Trump's public posture and statements during the campaign faithfully mirrored these attributes. We'll build a wall, torture our terrorist enemies, kill their families. Vladimir Putin, a strong leader, a real man, is not our problem so much as that wimp Obama and his lapdog, Hillary. Women, in fact, are either contestants in a perpetual beauty contest, winners like his own supermodel wife and ex-wives, or losers like Carly Fiorina and Heidi Cruz, or repositories of unsavory bodily fluids like Megyn Kelly. Indeed, Trump's ugliest moment, the Access Hollywood tape on which he boasted about sexual predation and assault in a manner too crude to repeat, was easily assimilated into his passionate man persona. It was not misogynistic contempt for women, but locker room talk. Read the way real men, virile athletic types, interact with each other in their man caves when no women are present. No one, moreover, not his supporters, his detractors, or even his wife, would deny that Donald Trump is a boyish character. Boy talk is how Melania characterized the Hollywood access outburst. Sometimes I say I have two boys at home, my young son and my husband. Remember that? Yeah. Sounds all but disqualifying, right? But doesn't that he does and says what he whatever he wants to, boyishness lie at the very core of what Trump's most fervent backers find so manfully insubordinate about him. Like Bush Jr., finally, Trump appropriated a powerful American myth of manhood, that of the self-made man. Mobile, competitive, aggressive in business, writes Kimmel, the self-made man of 19th century legend started with nothing and built an empire of capital by dint of his own hard work and ingenuity and perseverance. But we know, of course, that Trump is no more a self-made man than Bush was a real-life cowboy. He was born into great wealth, and his highly problematic father supported his every endeavor. As we now know, however, real masculine feats count for nothing in the Who's a Real Man show. And of that, Trump proved a master. Let's review the rules. Rule number one, cultivate a screen image of courage, resolve, and of courage and resolve, and display a willingness to exercise military force. Check. Rule number two, regardless of your personal wealth or status, impersonate a regular guy. Check. Rule number three, avoid appearing weak, indecisive, effeminate, or professorial. Check. That was easy. Rule number four, the image of real manhood trumps its reality. Yes, I went there, sorry. Double check. Looks like we have a winner. And as it turns out, the election unfolded as a reality show writ large, and we elected its locker room talking host, our next president. To be sure, make America great again meant make America white again. But above all, it meant make America manly again, or at least appear as much. So, where does all this leave us? What should we do about the current state of our politics, presidential and beyond? My counsel as your designated historian therapist is that we must first become more mindful about that state. We must heighten our awareness of how much our media shapes our reality. Because, my fellow Laurentians, we dwell in a postmodern version of Plato's cave. I see John Dreyer out there, we're back. And we too, as Plato suggests, are shackled such that we can, quote, only look straight ahead of us and cannot turn our heads. For that reason, we see nothing of our world except the shadows thrown by the fire on the wall of the cave opposite us. But for us, the wall is a 24-inch flat-screen TV or whatever electronic screen commands our attention at a given moment. Images, shadows of the real, continuously flash by in the form of movies, cable news, pictures, tweets, and Facebook posts. They are not real, but rather distort reality through the powerful cultural myths they propagate. For that reason, we must also confront those myths. Do we really want our politics to remain, even in part, a version of The Apprentice focused on who can best perform the part of real man, whose looks and sounds toughest, who seems the most regular guy, who seems the least effete and effeminate. Trump, as I've argued, represents only the logical culmination of the real man game we've made of presidential politics and races in the 21st century. Might we begin to remove our shackles, tear our eyes away from our screens and their man-boy icons? I include myself here as a movie buff who still enjoys rooting. I don't know where that went. Well, I won't keep you. Where am I? Rooting for diehards, cowboy cop John McClane, and that roguish billionaire businessman turned Iron Man, Tony Stark. You'd have a picture of Tony up there. But if only when choosing a president might we resist the thrill factor and escape factor offered by such myths of American manhood? Might we choose the real, male, female, or otherwise, over the hyper-real? Might we choose a flesh and blood grown-up? And I'll tell you, I really miss the picture that was up there of Provost Burroughs. with 2020. Might we choose a grown-up over a media-manufactured and juvenile version of a real man? Might we ourselves, at long last, grow up? Thank you.